Thanks, fellas, for being here. Thanks, fellas, for being here. And thanks for dancing with me. I was inspired by JT at the Academy Awards, and I thought, this is going to be as much fun as that. And you danced with Alita this morning, right?
Yeah.
So I saw some good news. I also want to thank all the alums, the fellows alums who agreed to do that, because I walked in and said, come on, let's do something like that. And they changed, they adopted real fast. All right, this is a really special moment for me. You're at Stanford University. How many of you are here for the first time in the Bay Area? In the Bay Area. Oh my, whoa, my goodness, that's incredible. So it's wonderful to have you here at this campus, but I also realized this morning that everybody on this panel is associated with Berkeley as well. So we have a lot of twofers here. I went to school there, I work here. Somebody still is working there a day a week right now, Tom K. So that's pretty cool. And then they are either directly or indirectly associated with every one of you and the 700 fellows that came before you, because something to do with the connection with this project over the last few years. I guess it's a fifth year anniversary of the University Innovation Fellows. So there's connections there. But I guess the thing that bonds us the most is we believe in change. And we believe in change in education. And we believe that innovation and entrepreneurship is the secret sauce for that. So we're going to talk about that for about the next half hour. Every single one of these people blow me away with big ideas every time I get a chance to sit with them, or I've sat with them in the past. They are people who see around corners. They think really big, really fast. And so, Steve, could you talk a little bit about your latest passion, the Hacking for Defense?
Let's see, am I on? Yeah. So, how many of you are familiar with the Lean Startup? All right, good.
Yeah, true.
You've been watching the video, you're all trained. So if you think about the Lean Startup idea, it's you come in with an idea and you use a methodology to both validate the problem, validate the solution by going out of the building and talking to customers and using a business model canvas to kind of test hypotheses and build minimum viable products. Any of that sound familiar to any of you? Yeah? So about a year ago, we kind of had a brainstorm that perhaps all of you, students across the country, could not only work on your ideas, but could work on ideas to help the country, to help the Department of Defense, to help the State Department, help cities, help nonprofits. That what if we use the same lean methodology you all learned, but instead of working on your ideas, a group of us would go out to the Department of Defense, or to the State Department, or to nonprofits, or to urban areas, and say, give us your toughest problems. We'll put them online and have our students select which ones they want to work on and use the same methodology to understand these problems deeply about an area of the country, government, state, nothing you ever knew anything about. Learn about it and build solutions in 10 weeks. And we did the first version of that class called Hacking for Defense here at Stanford last year. It's now scaled to 8 other universities. It'll probably be in 15 universities by the end of the year. Hopefully we could scale it as large as the National Science Foundation Innovation Corps in about 3 years. 3 weeks into the class, the State Department found out we were doing Hacking for Defense and said, how come you can't do one for state? And 90 days later, we stood up or started a class here at Stanford for the State Department called Hacking for Diplomacy, working on refugee problems and problems of diplomacy. Secretary of State Kerry kicked off the class, and Assistant Secretary of State, I'm blanking on his name, sat through the class and thought it was pretty wonderful. It would scale too if there was a State Department, but we're not sure who exactly we should be talking to. I think they're all applying for refugee status somewhere. But in any case, that will eventually scale because it solves the right class of problems. Here at Stanford, starting this fall, Hacking for Urban Resiliency, how to solve urban problems in the United States. And Errol will talk about our newest version of the hacking class called Hacking for Impact, which we're going to do for nonprofits and NGOs around the world. So students like you could work with the world's biggest and toughest nonprofit and NGO problems using the same exact lean methodologies which will pioneer and prototype at Stanford and hopefully roll out nationwide as well. So, Tom, that's what we've been up to in the last 90 days.
Yes, can I ask you a couple of questions about it? So how did we tweak the method, for example, right. Canvas? Give us one example.
It's a big idea. So everybody remember the business model Canvas, right? Canvas came from Alexander Osterwalder. Customer discovery came from me. Agile engineering came from Eric Ries. Some of those three we call a lean startup, right? What we observed, though, is if you look at a business model Canvas, anybody remember what the box on the bottom right is? Anybody remember? What does it say? Revenue. Okay, you're in the government. How do you measure success?
Personal.
Not revenue. You're in an NGO, non-profit. How do you measure success?
Change.
Right. So that box labeled revenue, where we're worried about revenue and profit, doesn't quite work for governments and nonprofits. There's another box labeled channel, which is meant shorthand for distribution channel. Not quite right for NGOs and government. While they deploy solutions and products and services, they don't have quite a sales force. So what we decided, Alexander Osterwalder, myself, and a couple of folks in government agencies, we had a conference for about half a day, and we reinvented the business model canvas for government agencies and nonprofits. There's a new version of the canvas called the mission model canvas. If you go online, type mission model canvas, you'll find a blog post from me and Alexander kind of describing the small but important changes. Instead of revenue, we have mission achievement and success. That is, how does each beneficiary measure success, and how does the organization measure success? Instead of channel, we have deployment. How are you deploying this, and more importantly, where are you getting the money from? Big idea, because this stuff doesn't get out to the field by itself. And then finally, customer relationships is now customer relationships and buy-in, meaning who in that immense bureaucracy of the government or that NGO has to approve this to make it happen. So Tom, those were the changes. And so for those of you thinking about using the business model canvas or lean for nonprofits and NGOs, you should now know there's a specific canvas designed for that called the mission model canvas.
Makes sense? That's a big idea to take, you know, and maybe you face the same thing I faced here the last 20 years being involved in innovation, entrepreneurship, education, is that there's like two camps. There's the community that's interested in it, you know, for-profit companies, and then there's the social entrepreneurship camp, and they don't really talk that much to each other. Well, this is the bridge. This is the ready-made bridge, and how powerful could that be? All right, so let's turn to Errol for a minute. Errol, let's go back a little bit. How many of you heard of the Innovation Core? Errol, tell us a little bit about that and how it's had impact.
Let me start with the genesis. So I was at the National Science Foundation in 2000, from 2003 to about 2013.
What's the NSF?
The National Science Foundation.
What's
a federal agency.
What's it do?
This is the second time in my life that Steve has asked me that question. The first time was followed by a couple of F-bombs. The National Science
Foundation.
That's
right, you said the same thing about Startup America.
It's a federal agency that focuses on primarily academic research, and it was started in the 1950s as a result of the impact that academic research had on the outcome of the Second World War. And so the federal government supports a whole ton of research in academic institutions in engineering and in biology and medicine, really to help bring forward knowledge for human betterment. And so the National Science Foundation has been around since 1952, has been historically one of the biggest supporters of engineering and computer science activity in the world. And in 2011, there was a new head of the National Science Foundation, the dean of the School of Engineering from MIT, who had experience in taking knowledge and turning it into value. And he wanted to do basically the same thing at NSF, the National Science Foundation. So he asked the engineering director at NSF, where I was working, can we put together a program that can support the translation of this research? And I had been there for about 7 years at that point, and the job fell on my desk. How do we put together a program to do this? Take academics and train them up in some activity that gives them the benefit of taking their technology and turning it into products and services. So that was 2011, and the first person that I called, literally, when that job fell to my desk was Steve. And I called up Steve and I said, hey, this is something we're working on. We want to use customer discovery. We want to use the business model canvas. We want to, in fact, co-opt, appropriate, steal, embrace, whatever, your class here that was being taught at Stanford and put it together in a way to span across the United States. And the reason I'm emphasizing the copy, the appropriate, the co-op, is because sometimes there are different roles that you play in life when you are a change agent. Sometimes you're coming up with the ideas. Sometimes you're spilling the blood to get those ideas to be born. Sometimes you're doing marketing to gather the resources to pursue them. And the succession planning that we heard in one of the previous talks is a really important part of how you plan for success. And so anyway, that was the genesis of the I-4 program that started in 2012, and now about 950 teams have gone through this activity. Teams of three, usually professors, graduate students, sometimes undergraduates, and an industrial mentor, really to take customer discovery and the business model canvas, what we call internally to the NSF, the scientific method applied to market opportunity recognition, and teach those teams how to identify which potential innovations have the ability to be sustainable, scalable, and high impact. So that's I think that was one of the reasons why I was invited here today.
And what other agencies have adopted this?
So the Department of Defense has a program, the National Institutes of Health has a program, DOE, the National Security Agency. I think that there's probably six or so around the United States, and across the world, I think about another dozen.
And does it matter there's a new administration in the office?
It does matter. You should get out and vote each and every time you get a chance to.
Vote early and often.
I know what Tom Kaye's going to say, but I just want to know what you're going to say.
So innovation happens to be one of those topics that is supported on both sides of the aisle, and I'm hopeful that it will maintain that way throughout the next several years.
And what are you doing nowadays?
I'm an investor in San Francisco, and I basically help companies, as they are taking technologies out of academic labs, turn those ideas, those scientific experiments, into real companies that provide products and services to better humanity.
And hacking for impact.
Yeah, and so coming back around to what Steve was talking about, what tell us a little bit about the course at Berkeley.
So Hacking for Impact is basically, it is the spinoff of Hacking for Defense, focused on NGO and applications where there may be a double bottom line, but certainly the impact is measured in ways other than simply revenue. And the idea is that we put together a core of instructors, domain experts, that have specific experience in double bottom line investing. And it really is a representative of a certain class of people that is different than if it was just a federal investment like the Department of Defense, certainly different than if it's private investment as in venture capital. And so it's kind of this split between the venture capital model and the public model, and there's a sort of a dual bottom line activity to it. We're not sure if it's going to require a new mission model canvas. I guess we'll have some dialogue over that over the course of the next several months. But this is another example of you don't have to come up with the entire idea itself. You can riff. You can riff off of success. And oftentimes that designing for those in-seam or those opportunities that are just a little bit orthogonal to what has already demonstrated to work can be very valuable. And I'm a proud copier of Steve Blank.
Thank you, Errol. All right, let's move on to Tom Kalil, I call him. And let me reintroduce him a little bit, since it's been a little while since Humero was up here. So Tom worked about 100 yards from the West Wing for 8 years, from January 2009 to January 20th. 2017.
17th.
January
17th. 3 days early.
All right. And so right next door is a building called the Executive Office Building, Eisenhower Building. There's the West Wing, and then right next door, right across the parking lot. And on the top floor, it has this really special office, Michelle Obama's. And then down the hall from that, it had an office having to do with all the advice, all the policies associated with science and technology for the United States. And he was number two. He was deputy director in that office. He was there the entire time. Some other people came and went, but the entire 8 years crafting the technology and science policy for the Obama administration across both sides of the aisle. So this is a really special opportunity. So welcome, Tom, again. Will you please?
So you've heard a lot about entrepreneurship in the startup context. I wanted to tell you a little bit about what it's like to do policy entrepreneurship, because I had the opportunity to recruit and mentor 19 policy entrepreneurs. And as opposed to launching businesses, our job was to talk to lots of smart people, like the people here, and try to identify ideas that we thought that the president should get behind. And the thought experiment that I used to pose to the members of my team is to imagine that you have a magic laptop. And the power of the laptop is that any press release that you write will come true. And you have to generate a headline, which is a goal statement, several paragraphs that provide context, and paragraph-level descriptions of who is agreeing to do what in the form organization A takes action B to achieve goal C. So as opposed to being interested in high-quality deal flow, which is the role of a venture capitalist, we were interested in high-quality idea flow. And once we came across an idea that we thought was worth paying attention to, we tried to figure out how we and the president could serve as a force multiplier for that idea. So I'll give you a couple of examples of that. So when I found out about the work that Errol and Steve and Tom and others were doing around the lean startup methodology, and that those faculty and students that were going through the program were getting SBIR funding at a much higher rate than those that had not gone through the program, I worked with that community to figure out how do we get not only the National Science Foundation doing this, but all the other agencies that are now involved, the National Institutes of Health, the Department of Energy, the Department of Defense, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one example of taking something that is working in one place and trying to get it to work in other places. Another example is the maker movement. So I had an opportunity to meet Dale Daugherty, who is the Johnny Appleseed of the maker movement, and eventually recruited a maker in residence to the White House. And we went with, you know, President Obama had decided if you win the Super Bowl or the NCAA, you get to come to the White House. The same thing should be true if you win a science fair or a robotics competition. So that was a huge success. The president got to meet this 16-year-old who was already using functionalized gold nanoparticles to kill cancerous tumors while leaving healthy cells untouched. And I don't know about you, but at 16, I was playing Dungeons and Dragons, right? Working on a cure for cancer. So we were all pretty impressed by this. He said, well, that was such a success. Why don't we have a maker fair in the White House? And, you know, we never told anyone, but we got this, where it came from, but we got an 18-foot robotic giraffe straight from Burning Man on the South Lawn of the White House. So just by the president, you know, calling attention to it, it really increased, you know, the visibility of the maker movement. There was an interdisciplinary group of, one of the questions that I always ask people is in the same way that President Kennedy said, let's have an astronaut on the moon and have him safely return by the end of the decade. And then more recently, we decided to not only sequence the human genome, but to drive down the cost of that from $100 million to $1,000. What are the similarly ambitious goals that we should be setting in the 21st century? And every once in a while, I get a really good answer to that question. So one foundation had brought together a workshop that had half people from neuroscience and half people from nanoscience. And the idea that they came up with is we might have an opportunity to do for our understanding of the brain what the Human Genome Project did for genetics. And the idea was we could develop the tools that would allow us to understand the brain in action and figure out how the brain encodes and processes information. In the same way that in molecular biology, we understand how information flows from DNA to RNA to proteins. And they said, you know, could this be one of the moonshots that President Obama gets behind? He ultimately decided the answer to that was yes. And we've been able to get $3 billion in funding to support multidisciplinary teams of researchers who are not only trying to transform our understanding of how the brain works, but ultimately improve our ability to diagnose, treat, prevent, and cure diseases of the brain. And it could also lead to fundamentally new computer architectures that are based on an understanding of how the human brain works. So that's what a policy entrepreneur does. They're involved in opportunity recognition, that is identifying good ideas, like the ideas from the people on this panel, and then figuring out who would need to do what in order to move those ideas forward. I used to tell people that the superpower of the White House was the ability to call people up and ask them to do something. So there was only two pieces of information that we needed. One is, who do you call? And the second is, what do you ask them to do? So that's how to become a policy entrepreneur, to answer those two questions.
Thank you so much, Tom. Let's take a couple of questions, and then I'm going to ask the panel to share their advice to you if they were in your shoes facing these incredible opportunities at your campuses, but also facing the reality that they are big bureaucracies. But if they can do what they've done in some of the organizations that you just heard about, you can do what you are going to do in the coming year. So we got some questions here. Let's go over here. Tell us who you know, where you're from as well, will you?
Hi, my name's Brandon from Rowan University in South Jersey.
Jersey.
Yeah, so Jersey people. My question is, so in our research of our campus's ecosystem, one of the hardest things that we found was to quantify our success on campus, to assign a metric to our impact to our students and surrounding region. Do you have any advice on how to do that or experience with, you know, share your experience with doing that?
All right, jump ball.
So,
hit the buzzer.
Yeah, so when I was at UC Berkeley, we started a program called Big Ideas at Berkeley. And the premise of the program was that students have ideas of their own, and sometimes they need just small amounts of funding to get started. So one of the ways that we explained how exciting that program is just to give them a sense for what has come out of it. So I'll give you one example. So one group of students got $3,000. They used that to pass a student fee referendum with 69% of the student vote that will generate $1.7 million to green the campus. One of the principal student organizers then got a fellowship to help another 10 to 15 universities adopt something similar. So there, we literally have hundreds of these stories at this point. And you can look at sort of macro statistics, like how much follow-on funding was generated as a result of these. But I think that the individual human stories about what the students accomplished and what lives they touched as a result of these projects is also very powerful.
Tom, let me take the complete opposite answer, just to be contrarian, to make a point. Most of your outcomes are going to be wrong. And the problem is if you don't benchmark them before, you'll never know that. It's a big idea, right? We're talking about measuring them after. But I think that's a mistake. It's a mistake I used to make for 20 years. And gee, how's our PR doing, our public relations? Well, let's measure it. Well, we never measured how people thought before. So step one, I would suggest, is write down what it is you want to accomplish, and then go out and measure what it is the state today before you do anything. And 90% of the time, you should all recognize your hypotheses of your impact is going to be wrong. And that's not a failure, that's learning. But if you don't assume that what you're running is an experiment, not a execution program, you're simply going to be surprised all the time and be depressed. Does that make sense? So my suggestion is a little different. Measuring it later is great, but if you don't know what you're measuring against, it's like saying the halftime score is 3.
It's like an impact test?
Well, before versus after.
So let's just follow up there. Steve has developed a really powerful framework called the investment readiness level. And at the highest level of investment readiness level, parallel to the technology readiness level that many of you know, but at the highest level of the investment readiness level is metrics that matter. And the reason why I think it's the highest is because you don't know what those metrics are going in. And it's only after you've worked through the business model a couple dozen times that you start to understand what the metrics are that drive success. And so you have to be, as Steve was saying, you have to be thinking about that up front, but you also have to be refining it as you're refining the business model itself so that you know what metrics you're going to use, what metrics you're going to embed in the system to demonstrate success. And of course, you want early success at all.
All right, let's take one from up here. Anybody want to ask a question up on the sky deck?
Yeah, sure.
Shout it out.
You guys were touching on success for a minute. How would you guys personally define success to your own?
Definition? All right, how do you personally define success? Let's go deep.
I'll take a stab at that. So personally,
where are you from?
James Madison.
James Madison, good.
In Virginia?
Yes, sir.
Very good. I think I got drunk there once. Or twice. So how many people have read the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? It's kind of a classic book. But one of the elements of that book is you begin with the end in mind. And I think that in terms of identifying personal success, it's kind of important to be thinking about what you want your legacy to be, what you want to be remembered for, what you want to have contributed to society, when you're gone. And my personal image is, what am I going to tell my grandkids, if I'm lucky enough to have grandkids, what am I going to tell my grandkids I did when, I'm sitting on the couch, 20, 30, 40 years from now?
So, I worked in Silicon Valley and startups for 21 years before I became an educator. And success for me was driving down, there's a main highway that cuts through the valley called Highway 101, going to work, not believing they were actually allowing me to work in this startup, and figuring out whether this was the day they were going to make me pay to work there, and truly, multiple times, calculating how much I could afford to actually pay them. The success for me, for at least a good part of my career, was working in some of the most exciting technology challenged, inventing new microprocessors or supercomputers or, of all things, believe it or not, video game company, which left a crater so deep it has its own iridium layer. So for a good chunk of my life, it was success was just dealing with exciting challenges in a company. After a while, I realized while I was doing that, everybody else was making a bucket of money except me. And then maybe I had to think about this stuff called stock and equity and whatever. And I was somewhat naive. And so in the last part of my career, I actually figured out how to love what I do, but make a ton of money at the same time. And so for a while, the value was an equal that. As an educator, my value was actually realizing that I could change how entrepreneurial education and then how entrepreneurs and then how companies and then how the government actually commercialized what they did. And I just kicked over a lot of walls, meaning my career as an educator was even more fun by calling BS on almost everything that we've been teaching in business schools in the last 50 years. And working for Tom, who let me do it, because we were in the engineering school. So value kind of changes as you get older, and then eventually you converge. And what Errol said is, as you start getting really old, you start thinking about, did you move the needle at all for yourself and for your community and for your country? And that was my version.
So the thing that I've enjoyed the most is serving as a force multiplier for an individual or a team or a community that has a big idea. And taking what I've learned, which is how do you have influence without authority, and how do you build coalitions, and how do you identify leverage points to try to make things happen at a faster and more ambitious scale?
All right, thank you. Any of your questions right here? Introduce yourself, please. Thanks.
I'm Kelsey. I'm from George Fox University, and my question is mostly for Tom. It's you're talking about how it's important to identify people and opportunity. I'm wondering how can we help opportunities? Like, how can we be found, and how can we help people be found by those identifiers and policymakers?
Well, one way to do that is just to provide people an opportunity to participate. So I think one of the most useful things about big ideas at Berkeley, for example, is that it put some questions out there. And each of those questions was accompanied by a deadline and a small amount of money. And that, so the students that had an idea that they were passionate about were able to self-identify themselves as someone who wanted to work on a big problem at home or abroad. So that's a very effective way to do it.
Can I throw in something on that? What's really important for everybody in this room is to look beyond the obvious folks on your campus that, you know, say are already in the entrepreneurship club, you know, always do all the business plan competitions. That core group, you go, okay, they do, you know, they are excited about entrepreneurship. They came to college that way. You know, maybe they had little businesses when they were in high school, all that. That's obvious. Or on the design side. You know, they've been designing stuff since they were 5 years old. That's wonderful. That's a nice little beachhead, is to look at every single person on the campus, social, economic, wise, or any other way. You know, the diversity of the campus is really, really important. It's all here at Stanford, then, it's all about the 16,000 students here, not just these folks that came pre-wired. And that's where the big opportunities are on your campus. And and it took me a little while to wake up to that after we got things started here about 20 years ago. But it's really clear, and it's, you know, kind of obvious. I'm not pandering to the topics of the day right now, but given the topic of the day, that's a gigantic opportunity to seize the topic of diversity right now and then be a leader in it, rather than just leaving things to status quo. That's my view on that.
We've got five minutes.
We got one. Let's take one more back there. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Sheila Williams. I'm from Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland. And my question is, my personal venture, I'm trying to get a barbershop here on my campus, but I guess the ecosystem of my school is a lot of red tape. And we had actually did the rapid prototyping, and we had used one of the lounges to actually do the barbershop, and it worked. But then the issue was the higher head of the housing, he said that he didn't want to be liable for what's going on. So I guess my larger question is, how do you do rapid prototyping? How do you get into it? What if the whole bureaucracy is wrong?
Yeah, how do you deal with saboteurs? How about some advice?
Well, you know, I think what you just articulated is always a surprise, even as many times as you deal with it, is that if you don't, anybody know the rule in poker, that if you don't know who the fool at the table is, it's you? And I'm not talking about you being the fool, I'm talking about if you don't know who the saboteur is, you're going to be surprised. And in your case, the saboteur just raised their hand and said, irrationally, because if you really would go get a lawyer and say, no, the school's not liable and whatever. But typically, to deal with saboteurs, you need to figure out what they're afraid of. And usually what they're afraid of is either a loss of authority, or they're unsure about their own position, or, gee, you know, they don't want you to succeed because it makes them nervous and whatever. And someone just pulled out the rule book on you and said, honestly, I'm really nervous about this. And the way you deal with saboteurs is, A, you don't ignore them, you actually try to understand what their deep issues are, not what their perceived issues are, and then you figure out how to address those issues. Very few times you succeed by bulldozing over them, but sometimes it's actually quite useful to address their needs or to find others that could address their concerns as well. Usually an argument is the wrong way, though it used to be my first approach. It was more like try to understand what's really bothering them deeply. Errol or Tom?
Well, as Tom said and as Steve said, it's about building a coalition. That's the first point that I want to make. And the second point that I want to make is that they've actually given you a favor in identifying themselves as saboteur. Oftentimes, there's a saboteur behind the scenes and you just don't even know it. The other thing is, who has solved this problem already? So for example, there are commercial companies that have to get liability insurance. And you better believe they make sure that someone is trained in how to use a CNC machine tool or a laser cutter before they're allowed to use it. So there are ways to, the right way to do this is to understand the risk and responsibly management, not to say that there will never be any risk under any circumstances, because then otherwise we'd never do anything. We'd never get in the car.
Did you say barbershop?
Well, there's no laser cutting in barbershop. I thought she said rapid prototype.
Yeah. Okay. Join me. We got to stay on time. I wish we could stay here the rest of the afternoon. Oh, what the hell, let's do. No, I wish we could. But you have a lot more fun stuff to get to. And I want you to join with one of those big UIF woohoos for these three people. Please join me. Let's do it.